My dear respected brothers and sisters, once again, I thank Allah Almighty for giving me the opportunity to visit you. And I thank you all, brothers and sisters, for making an effort to be here in this very hot weather. May Allah accept from all of us. Ameen. And the sound hadith, which is collected by Imam Bukhari and Muslim Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said, كُلُّ أُمَّتِي يَدُخُلُونَ الْجَنَّةَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَبَى. Such glad tidings. He said, all my ummah, every single member of my ummah, all my followers, everybody who says I'm Muslim shall enter paradise except those who refuse. So they said, O Prophet of Allah, and who will refuse to enter paradise . Would any of us refuse to enter heaven? It's our ultimate goal. It's our dream. Who would refuse to enter al-Jannah? So the Prophet, peace be upon him, said, مَنْ أَطَاعَنِي دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ وَمَنْ عَصَانِي فَقَدْ أَبَى. Whoever obeys me shall enter paradise. And whoever disobeys me, he refuses to enter paradise. So by disobeying the commands of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, going against his sunnah or rejecting his traditions, the person makes the choice not to enter paradise. Approaching the conclusion of his mission and right before his death, our most beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam drew a road map for us. He did not leave us without guidance in case that if he were to die today. So he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I'm leaving for you two things. If you hold fast to them, you will never ever go astray. What are the two things? He said, the book of Allah and what? Sunnati. He said, sunnati, what is the term sunnah? What does it mean? Many of us perceive sunnah as the two rak'ahs that we pray before or after the fard namaz, the fard prayer, the two rak'ahs after maghrib or duha prayer, or the witch fasting on the 10th of Muharram, fasting on the 9th of Dhul Hijjah, etc. These are all sunnah. But what is the broader meaning of the term sunnah when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when I die, there are two things. As long as you're holding fast to them, you shall never go astray. What are they? The book of Allah, we all know it. From Al-Fatiha to An-Nas. And what is the Sunnah? The applied meaning of the term Sunnah is every saying, actions, and approvals of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So whatever he says, do or do not do, that's a saying. Whenever he advises verbally, that's a saying. And whenever he does anything, even if he doesn't talk about it, and the companions prescribe that to us and they say, I have seen. So this is a legislation. Uthman ibn Affan, may Allah be pleased with him, once ordered water and he performed wudu. And he said, this is exactly how I have seen Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, performing wudu. Then he said, whoever performs wudu like that, then prays two rak'ahs, his previous sins will be forgiven. So the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam observed and transmitted to us whatever they have seen the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam doing, his actions. That's why he said, صَلُّوا كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي أُصَلِّي. Pray as you have seen me praying. Many of the rituals, of the ibadat, you do not find a hadith in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, do or do not do. But rather, the description of the companions of how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did or did not do anything. The sunnah could be by actually doing or by not doing. Anas ibn Malik, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated that on the day of the Battle of Uhud, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam buried the 70 martyrs, Al-Hamza and the remaining 70 shuhada. He buried them in their clothes. He didn't wash their bodies, nor did he offer Salatul Janazah upon them. He didn't offer the funeral prayer. What is this called? Tark. He didn't do something which he would normally do in regular circumstances. So we understood from that, that if somebody dies as a shaheed on a battlefield, his body is not to be washed, there is no need to offer the funeral prayer for them. They're going straight to heaven. And the remaining component of the definition, sunnah, is either approvals or disapprovals. When the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, heard at Amr ibn al-As, radiyallahu anhu, he was appointed as the commander chief in an expedition, that is Salasil. And at night, he experienced wet dream, which required him to perform ghusl to lift the major impurity. And since he was the Amir and he's in charge of leading the prayer, early morning it was extremely cold. So he consulted the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even those who've accepted Islam before him. He said, "The water is extremely cold. Is there a way that I can resort to tayammum instead of taking bath with the cold water? It may ruin me." They said, "No." Because the ayah in the Quran says, "فَلَمْ تَجِدُوا مَاءً فَتَيَمَّمُوا." You can only perform tayammum in case of absence of water. The water is there. It is cold, yet, but it is present. So he did not go according to their view. Rather, he still performed tayammum and he led the prayer. Then when they returned, they complained to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about what Amr ibn al-As did. So the Prophet collected him and he said, "Ya Amr, أَصَلَّيْتَ بِالنَّاسِ وَأَنْتَ جُنُبْ." How dare you lead the prayer while you are in a state of janaba? He said, "O Prophet of Allah, I read in the book of Allah that Allah the Almighty says, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِكُمْ رَحِيمًا." Don't you kill yourselves. Allah is most merciful with you. So I thought for myself, if I were to shower with a cold water, I would kill myself. So I complied with the command of Allah. What did the Prophet ﷺ do? He smiled. This smile of him means taqreer, approval. So everyone after Amr ibn al-As, in case of the presence of water, but he cannot use it due to sickness, allergy, or it is extremely cold and he cannot warm it up, go ahead and perform tayammum to lift even the major impurity. That's called taqreer. It could be by the opposite. The Prophet ﷺ disapproves something which sounded great, like those three companions who wanted to compete with the Prophet ﷺ in respect of worship. So one of them vowed not to skip a single day, but to fast on every single day. And the other vowed to pray on every single night for the whole night. And the third made a vow not to marry. Why? They wanted to devote their entire lives for the worship of Allah. How did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam receive such information? Did he applaud that? Did he encourage them? Did he approve it? Rather, it is on the contrary. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not speak to them in private. He gathered the whole ummah. Then he made a very important remark. He said, "Indeed, I'm the most knowledgeable one of all of you about Allah, the most fearing for Allah of all of you. I'm the dearest to Allah of all of you, yet I fast some days and I skip some other days. I pray at night and I rest as well, and I'm married. So whoever turns away from mine," what was the word? "فَمَنْ رَغِبَ عَنْ سُنَّتِي." Whoever turns away from my legislation, my traditions, then he doesn't belong to me. So what is the term sunnah? It is a form of legislation. It is as powerful, as authoritative as the Quran exactly. The reason why we chose this topic, because a few weeks ago, after I prayed Maghrib in one of the masajid, I was leaving. Then some brothers in the masjid, some elders and uncles, asked me, we're having a dilemma. We have a member in the community who have heard the dars, a hadith. And he said, nah, I don't believe in that. That doesn't make any sense. Oh, I said that, but this is a sound hadith. He said, we know it's a sound hadith. But he said, it's not only about this hadith. He said, I only believe in the Quran. If it is not mentioned in the Quran, I don't buy it. Whatever you guys call it, hadith and Bukhari and Muslim and prophetic traditions are all man-made. God vowed in the Quran to preserve only the Quran. Even though I was really busy, but I thought the matter is very important. So I sat with them. And I addressed the brother. What is wrong? He said, those hadith don't make any sense. I said, have you prayed Maghrib with us? He said, yes. I said, MashaAllah. How many rak'ah is Maghrib? He said, 3. I said, where can you find in the book of Allah where Allah says pray Maghrib 3 rak'ahs? Maghrib, we recite it out loud. I had to recite out loud. But the previous prayer, Asr, was 4 rak'ahs, and it was a quiet prayer. You recite on your own, not audible. Where do you find in the book of Allah from cover to cover where Allah the Almighty said Asr is 4 rak'ahs, but it is not allowed prayer, like Zuhr, while Maghrib and Isha and Fajr are allowed prayers. Maghrib is 3 versus Fajr is only 2. Where do you find all of that? He got stuck. Said, and in sujood, in rukur, the prescription of how to make actually sujood, what to recite while standing, the tashahud, the tahiyyat, the adhkar, none of that is mentioned in the Quran. The Quran simply says, aqimu salah wa atu zakah, establish the prayers and pay the due alms. It doesn't give the detailed explanation. I said, after Ramadan in Eid, and before the Eid prayer, did you pay Zakatul Fitr? He said, of course. And I even paid extra. He said, MashaAllah, extra to what? To how much? How much is Zakatul Fitr? Where does it say in the Quran that Zakatul Fitr is sa'? Almost 3 kilograms of dates, raisin, or rice, or its value. Where does it say that? He said, it should be in the Quran. I said, show it to me. From cover to cover. He said you paid extra. Extra to what? What is the fixed amount? As a matter of fact, Zakatul Fitr is a fard. But it was never mentioned in the Quran. Abdullah ibn Abbas says, Farada Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Sadaqat al-Fitr Sa'a min tabrin aw sa'a min sha'irin aw sa'a min zabib. He said the Prophet, peace be upon him, ordained. He made it fard. It's an obligation. Exactly like zakat on wealth. And there is no such mention in the Quran to zakatul fitr. So how did you pay zakat while it was not mentioned in the Quran for fitr? And the timing, and the rate, the amount, and who should pay, and who are the recipients? Wait a minute. Zakat on wealth itself. Zakat on crops. Zakat on the grains, all of that is not mentioned in details in the Quran. The Quran says give zakat, but it doesn't say how much. It doesn't say rubu al-ush, 2.5% on wealth. Nor does it say that you have to pay on the same amount annually. A lot of things, the Quran is mujmal, and the Sunnah came to explain it in details. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, while performing Hajj, how many Hajj did he perform? How many Hajj? Only once. And that's why in Arafah, when he was wrapping it up, he said, فَلْتَأْخُذُوا عَنِّي مَنَاسِكَكُمْ. Take your Hajj rituals from me. Learn your Hajj ceremonies from me. Learn your Hajj rites and imitate me. Then, while throwing the stones, he said the same. فلتأخذوا عني مناسككم. Given the farewell speech, فلتأخذوا عني مناسككم. Since I may not be with you next year. Quran says, أتموا الحج والعمرة لله. But the detailed explanation of doing tawaf first in 7 rounds, then what to say in tawaf, to begin from the Blackstone corner, going to sa'i afterward, and all the details, throwing the stones, spending the night in Muzdalifah, none of that is explained in the Quran. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, radiyallahu anhu, was in Iraq after the Prophet's death. Then once he quoted a hadith. The hadith is narrated by other companions, Aisha, Ibn Umar, and others, where he said, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ النَّامِصَةَ وَالْمُتَنَمِّصَةَ وَالْوَاشِمَةَ وَالْمُسْتَوْشِمَةَ وَالْوَاصِلَةَ وَالْمُسْتَوْصِلَةَ وَالْمُتَفَلِّجَاتِ لِلْحُسْنِ الْمُغَيِّرَاتِ لِخَلْقِ اللَّهِ. He said, may Allah curse the one who plucks her eyebrows and the one who does it for others. May Allah curse the one who gets tattoos and the one who does it for others. The one who wears a wig and the one who connects the hair of others with other hairs which is not hers. And the one who files her teeth in order to change the creation of Allah so they look beautiful. Allah didn't create them this way. They shave their eyebrows or they pluck them and they redraw them. It's a major sin. So this woman, and this woman was a qari'a lil Quran. She had read the Quran from cover to cover. She came rushing and she said, how dare you curse somebody whom Allah didn't curse? He said, and why shouldn't I curse whom Allah have cursed? She said, Allah didn't. I read the Quran from cover to cover. There is no such mention. There is no ayah about a nams or plucking the eyebrows. And this is what a lot of sisters rely on today and say, it's not in the Quran, then I don't have to worry about it. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said to him, you sure that you read the Quran from cover to cover? She said, certainly. He said, have you read it? You would have found it. It's an ayah in Surah Al-Hash. Ayah number 7. The Almighty Allah says, وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. What does it say? Whatever the Messenger of Allah gives you, يعني commands you to do it, then you must do it, comply with that command. But it's not mentioned in the Quran. The saying of the Prophet is as authoritative as the Quran exactly. Why? I'll tell you why. وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُ. And whatever he forbids you against that, then you must abstain from it totally. You just mentioned that whatever the Prophet ﷺ said or did or approved or disapproved is as powerful, as authoritative as the Quran itself. Absolutely, because the Quran says so. In Surah An-Najm from 1 to 4, the Almighty Allah begins by swearing. Why would Allah have to swear and take an oath? To confirm the subject of the oath. وَالنَّجْمِ إِذَا هَوَى. Allah is swearing. I swear to the star as it descends. مَا ضَلَّ صَاحِبُكُمْ وَمَا غَوَى. Your companion, يعني Muhammad, peace be upon him, never went astray, nor did he err. وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى. And he does not utter a word out of his whim, on his own. إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى. Whatever he utters is simply a revelation that is revealed to him. Anything pertaining to Tashri'a and legislation. So he was given the same power of legislation like the Quran exactly. You know, if we don't have the Sunnah, how much should be the Quran in order to explain to us everything? Books would fill this whole place or even more to explain to us how to pray. You know what happens if you pray an extra rak'ah? You pray 5 instead of 4. What do you do? Well, I pray 2 sajdas, 2 prostrations for forgetfulness. And what if you pray short? What do you need to do? Make up an extra rak'ah, then the 2 prostrations for forgetfulness. Where did you learn all of that? Huh? Where did you learn all of that? The Sunnah. وما ينطق عن الهوى إن هو إلا وحي يوحى. In Surah An-Nisa, ayah number 23, Allah the Almighty listed those who are forbidden to be taken in marriage permanently, permanent mahram. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَأُحِلَّ لَكُمْ مَا وَرَاءَ ذَلِكُمْ. After this list of women who are forbidden for you to marry eternally, anything otherwise is halal. But there came the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he added to this list another prohibition. Has the same power of authority like the ayah itself, even though it isn't mentioned in the ayah. To the extent that some of the scholars perceive this matter as some sort of abrogation. Sunnah may abrogate the Quran. What is the Sunnah? It is a source of legislation as powerful as the Quran exactly. General consensus among all the scholars of the mainstream ummah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the ayah, وَأَن تَجْمَعُوا بَيْنَ الْأُخْتَيْنِ إِلَّا مَا قَدْ سَلَفْ. It is not permissible to marry to two sisters simultaneously. Somebody will say, and who would do that? As a matter of fact, some of the prophets did so. Did you call a prophet who's married to two sisters simultaneously? You know, there was a prophet who was married to two sisters at the same time? Prophet? Yaqub or Israel? Who was the children of Israel are his children. He was married to two sisters at the same time. That is in the Old Testament as well. So the Quran abrogated that. Then the ayah ended. وَأَن تَجْمَعُوا بَيْنَ الْأُخْتَيْنِ إِلَّا مَا قَدْ سَلَفْ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said anything beyond that is halal. There comes the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the sunnah and he adds to that and he said, وَأَنْ يُجْمَعَ بَيْنَ الْمَرْأَةِ وَعَمَّتِهَا أَوِ الْمَرْأَةِ وَخَالَتِهَا. And it is not permissible to marry a woman and her aunt, whether paternal or maternal, period. That's not permissible. Even though it is mentioned in the Quran. Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith which is narrated by others, and all of you know it, how the previous nations were divided. And in this particular hadith, it talks only about Bani Israel were divided into 72 sects, and he said all of them are astray. And he prophesied the divisions among his ummah by saying that, and this ummah will be divided into 73 millah. Some of these divisions and sects are so astray that they call themselves Muslims, but they're not. Millah, it's a different religion. Like those people, by the end of the meeting, after I talked to this person, I was forced to expose him to the audience that he belongs to a party or a sect which is called the Quranists. They say, we only believe in the Quran. Oh yeah? You don't believe in the Quran. If you do believe in the Quran, you're obliged to believe in the Sunnah. I'm gonna quote tens of verses right now from the Quran, commanding those who believe in the Quran, they should believe in the saying of the Prophet ﷺ and his commandments. The Quranists or Al-Quraniyun, the Prophet warned against them. So first of all, the Prophet ﷺ said, and the Ummah will be divided into 73 sects, all of whom are astray, all of whom will go to hell, except for one sect. What I love about the companions is that they focus on the main point. They don't waste time. They said, oh Prophet of Allah, they didn't ask, who are those who will go astray? Rather they say, which sect will be saved? One of people concerned about, how can we be saved in case that you leave before us? The answer is the most comprehensive answer. Luckily, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't give that sect a name. But guess what? All the 73 sects and the subsects and the subsects, all of them would adopt the same name. He didn't give a name. You know why? Because actions speak louder than words. He rather gave a description. He said, those who will be following whatever I am following today and my companions. What is this called? Sunnah. You want to be among the saved party? You want to be a true Muslim? There's no alternative. You just have to follow Prophet Muhammad and whatever his companions have done, because they have strictly followed his guidance. Strictly?
Yes.
In one incident, Abu Sa'id al-Khudri narrated that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was leading the prayer. And all of a sudden, he took his na'layn. He was wearing sandals. He took them off and he kicked them to the left. And he stood in the prayer barefooted. So the whole crowd, the mu'min, did likewise, started taking off their boots, their shoes, their khuf, their sandals, and they kicked them away. After the prayer, Rasulullah ﷺ turned around and said, "What is wrong? Why all of you are not wearing your shoes or boots?" They said, "Because we have seen you in the prayer, you have taken your shoes off, so we imitated you. We thought it has been abrogated, and from now on you cannot pray while wearing your shoes." The Prophet ﷺ said, "Don't do that. If there was any change, I would have instructed you. So why did you do that?" He said, "Jibreel alayhi salam came to me in the prayer and said, 'Muhammad, your na'l has some adha, some impurities. You cannot pray with najasa on your shoes, on the sole.' So I had to take them off and I kicked them away." Look at how strict the companions were whenever it comes to imitating anything the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to do. And Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, one of the companions, "Don't tell me time is up." I feel good. So they do whatever he would do. Way after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away, whenever they would see Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab approaching from distance, they would confuse him with the Prophet and they would think that the Prophet has come back to life. Why? Because Abdullah ibn Umar used to imitate the Prophet even in the way he walked. So they see his shadow, they say, "Allahu Akbar, Rasulullah is back to life." This is how strict they were in imitating the Prophet ﷺ. He's giving the khutbah and he says, "Whoever was standing, sit down." People were still coming. MashaAllah, we're sitting in the tent in the shade. I know that some of you feel hot and you keep... But imagine those who are standing outside. So the Prophet ﷺ said, "Sit down." Some of the companions were about to set their foot in the masjid. They heard, "Man kana qa'iman falyajlis," let whoever standing sit down. So they sat down under the burning sun, on the burning sand. Why? Instant compliance, very strictly adhering to the command of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Umar ibn Khattab radiyallahu anhu kisses the black stone and he says, he's addressing the stone, and he says, "By Allah, I know that you're just a stone. You do not benefit, nor do you protect against any harm. Have I not seen the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, kissing you? I wouldn't have done so." You see, the proper understanding of the deen, not rejecting the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they want a liberal deen. Because if you don't take the sunnah, if you, as you claimed, you rely only on the Quran and you reject any hadith, then basically you don't practice Islam. Not a single ibadah is prescribed in details in the Quran, but the Quran gives the general command, then the sunnah explains it in details. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was commanded, "Khudh min amwalihim sadaqatan tutahhiruhum wa tuzakkihim biha," Allah said, "Take a sadaqa," yani the zakat, "out of their wealth, in order to purify them thereof and to sanctify them with it." How much shall I take out of their money? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspired them through the wahi as what to do in this regard. The sunnah is wahi to brothers and sisters. Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As used to record the sayings of the Prophet. So some of the elders came to him and said, "No, don't do that." Because he's a human being. Sometimes he says things while he's angry, maybe he doesn't mean it. So he quit recording the hadith. Then he came to the Prophet ﷺ and said, "Ya Rasulullah, I used to record and writing every saying of yours, but Quraysh forbade me and they said that this and this and that." So the Prophet ﷺ said, "Uktub Abdullah resumed writing, I swear to Allah, nothing comes out of these two lips but the truth. Nothing comes out of these two lips but the truth. وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. He doesn't utter a word, a letter out of his own, out of his whim. It is simply but a revelation that is revealed unto him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When Allah the Almighty says in ayah number 9, Surah Al-Hijr, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. Most certainly it is us who send down a dhikr. And most certainly we shall preserve it. He has set the alarm on and it keeps bugging me. Nice move. What is a dhikr in this ayah? Because he also said that what was preserved is only the Quran. But the Sunnah has been changed and fabricated. The divine promise to preserve a dhikr. Read through the Quran. Number one in Surah An-Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 44. Allah Almighty says, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. Listen to this ayah and check it out. وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ. We have sent unto you, O Muhammad, al-dhikr. To do what? In order to explain to them what has been revealed unto them. So the Mufassirin said, al-dhikr in the first term refers to the sunnah, which explains what has been revealed unto them, which is the glorious Quran. And both are being preserved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters, I know that it's almost time, so I want to wrap it up by this serious prophetic warning. Sit down, akhi, sit down. Rest. This is the introduction to wrap it up. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the hadith, which is narrated by Al-Miqdam ibn Ma'di Karib. Remember the name of this companion. He said, أَلَا إِنِّي أُوْتِيتُ الْقُرْآنَ وَمِثْلَهُ مَعَهُ. Most certainly I have been given the Qur'an and similar to it along with it. What is similar to it? The Sunnah which explains it, which completes and complements the legislation. Then he said, أَلَا لَا أُلْفِيَنَّ رَجُلًا مُتَّكِئًا عَلَىٰ أَرِيكَتِهِ. I hope not to see a man reclining on his couch. And he says, well, I only take whatever is mentioned in the Quran. If it says haram in the Quran, then I will take it. If it doesn't, then I don't care about it. Indeed, Allah has given me the power of legislation like the Quran, giving me the sunnah similar to the Quran. Then he said, indeed, I have made gold and silk forbidden for men. And it's not mentioned in the Quran, is it? We all know that men are not allowed to wear gold and silk. And once a man was sitting in the presence of the Prophet ﷺ wearing a beautiful gold ring. So Rasulullah ﷺ took it off his finger and he threw it away. And he said, why would one of you tend to wear a burning coal around his hand? Don't you know that gold and silk are forbidden for men? Then after the Prophet ﷺ was dismissed, the Sahaba said, why don't you pick up your ring? You can sell it, you can do anything out of it. He said, no, not after the Prophet ﷺ threw it away. Even though it is permissible to give it to your honey, to give it to your wife, to give it to anyone who may wear it. The Prophet ﷺ, throw it away. How dare am I to pick it up and make a use out of it? Brothers and sisters, there is no Islam without the sunnah of our most beloved Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. One ayah in the Quran Allah tested all of us with, they call it Ayatul Ikhtibar. Ayah number 31, Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Say, O Muhammad, your followers, and I'm transmitting the command. If you truly love Allah, then follow me, the Prophet says. Follow the Prophet. And if you do, Allah will love you and forgive you your sins May Allah grant us all forgiveness. May Allah guide us what is best. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us all steadfast on his straight path. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.